What's up, guys? This is Mayan Gordon. I'm the owner of Mayan Gordon Media, and we are here live at 5 with a really special guest and a really good friend of mine. Her name is Liza, and she is so many things. She's an Amazon business owner. She's a successful influencer at like a really high level of influence, not just online, but really offline as well. And we'll talk a little bit about that. Has had, you know, so many unique, diverse experiences, from traveling all over to working with, you know, all sorts of famous, cool people. And I think has so much value and perspective to share with us from so many different angles. A beautiful Latina, has, you know, an amazing love for, I think, culture, family, art, you know, creation. So why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself much better than I can, and tell people what we're here to talk about today, which is a very exciting event that you were recently a huge part of.
Yeah. So first and foremost, thank you so much to you, Mayan, as well to everybody that's tuning in. A big shout out to my dear Love Bug Nation. I know several of you will be watching as well. So definitely just a friendly reminder, if you have comments, questions, feel free to drop them in the comments below. This is live. We're here to be of service to you. That is something Absolutely. That my community knows, that I lead with service. The way that I can help others work smarter, not harder, I feel is a big win for all of us. So first and foremost, I would say I'm an actor. I've been a storyteller since I was a child. I started in the business when I was 10. I had my first talk show at 10. So I knew very early on that telling stories and sharing them with as many people as possible, and also telling stories that wouldn't necessarily be heard, was my calling on earth. And sometimes those stories are scripted. Sometimes those stories are true. Sometimes it's in between. So it's really great. I have both a journalistic background as well as an acting background. I have my master's in both, actually. So that's really awesome. And so in being able to do that, I really love being able to bring my community along with me on this journey. So yes, indeed, pre-corona, as I like to call it, BC, before corona, you would definitely-
I heard you say that. It's so cute.
Yes, is that I am definitely the Carmen Sandiego of live stream. Twitter actually named me one of their 10 most inspirational women in 2016. So Periscope, when that popped off, yes, so thank you.
I mean, are you guys listening to this just like litany of accomplishments, of just really contributions is what I'd call them. So
I am
in awe of you, and I definitely look up to what you've done what you've been, you know, deciding to do with all of your influence and experience.
Yeah. So, you know, I've been in the live stream game basically since it really popped off with Periscope, and I've been in every
And what year was that, to give people context? So like
2015, 2016. Yeah, it took off, and God, I can't even believe it was like already that long ago. It feels like ages ago. But even before that, like there was different versions, but you know, then you had Blab, and then, I mean, it's continued on into where we're at now, that we're on LinkedIn, and you have Facebook right. Live, and you have, you know, Instagram Live. You
so,
just have
so many. There's separate live streaming apps, and yeah, so many.
You also have so many that have ended up in the digital graveyard, RIP, Vine being one of them. That was one of the yep. big ones that I went viral on back in the day. And so it's been cool to see just how everybody is embracing. Obviously, as you know, with TikTok, it really is Vine 2.0, but it's cool because it's Vine and then some, right? Which I guess is where that 2.0 comes in. But what I like about it is that the team behind it has really learned a lot of the things where the original Vine went amiss. And I think even Instagram's trying to do that now. And that is to really cater to the content creator on a level of not like, hey, we want to give you everything, but more on a level of like, yo, we see that you all are dedicating your time, your efforts, your creativity to creating content that makes an impact. So let's make sure that not only do we reward you for that, but we give your community a way to interact with you. So I don't know if you heard, this is fresh off the presses. Hopefully I don't get in trouble. But it is coming to IG in the next couple of weeks that they are testing out the monetization.
Yeah, no, that's I've seen news articles about that. So it's not an official leak. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
That's really interesting.
I've
Have you looked into it all to see what the structure and like dynamic is?
Uh-huh. Yep. Okay. I've known about it for a bit. There's not too much that you talk about yet, but it is coming. I think what it's really cool is that it reminds me a lot of what we saw with the Chinese apps when, which again, TikTok, I think, would be a leader in this space, being that they are owned by China, even though I do appreciate that the former CEO of of Disney Digital has now come over to TikTok. I think that's going to help soothe a lot of nerves that people had here in the United States. But, you know, one of the things I remember from going to China when I was there scoping, I did a trip with Lenovo. Well, I've been there a few times, but I did this trip with Lenovo. And I remember their version of Periscope. It was interesting being on it because I started getting all these jewels and these coins. And I was like, what is happening? And again, mind you, this is 2016-ish. And they're like, oh, look at this is how much you have. You have to send us your account so that we can send you the money.
Right. I was like,
what are you talking about? And so it was so crazy to see that doing the same thing that I do here, you know, that I was able to do it in China, but that they, of course, China does it better in some ways.
Earlier, typically. Yeah.
Yes. But the fact that they really were leveraging tech to be there for the creators. So it's we knew it was coming to the US. It was just a matter of when. So it's kind of nice to see that Instagram is picking up that slack, if you will. I'd love to see TikTok do that as well, because I think there's so many amazing creators on there. You know, when it was Musical.ly, you know, there was a big balance. Is it just going to be for the kids? Is it not? Right. I think the quarantine really helped bring everybody, DC during, you know, Corona, really helped bring everybody together onto TikTok. And so you have millennials just as much as you have Gen Z, just as much as you even have boomers.
Older adoption, right.
I'm sure the kids are not too happy about, but that being said, you know, it is great because it is still a platform where anyone and everyone could be found. So unlike some of the other ones where the algorithm isn't necessarily working for you, what I love about TikTok is that, and Gary Vee's been talking about this for a year now, but is that it's still today, like you haven't missed the boat. Like you could definitely get on, start creating. I know you and I have talked about it because not like I'm not on enough platforms already, but I was like, you know what? I think I miss mine and I miss, you know, chatting with that. I have a lot of youngins that follow me, little love bugs. I'd love to connect with them and have some fun.
Oh, it's so great for that yammer. Like if you love kids, TikTok's such a, I love my younger like audience. Yep. They're so sweet and supportive and have great ideas that they want to share. Absolutely.
And I think that's the great thing about social media, right? And I remember being, as I said, I was 10 years old when I had my first talk show. And so I relate to being a young storyteller and just wanting to be heard and respected for the stories I had to share, as opposed to being told, you're little, you don't have anything worthy. And I was like, actually, that's not correct. So what's great about that is that I would empower people in the same way, regardless of age, to really use some of these principles. Now, one of the things I told my community that I was going to be sharing while we were on here is definitely tips, things that they can put into action. So I would say right off the bat, one navigating guideline that I've used for my life is to always be creating. I call it ABCs. Like you should always be creating. And then always when you're creating, you want to make sure that it's in the framework of three main things. I think my community knows just how important it is for me, for them to be served, if you will, for me to bring them value. So anything and everything that I create always falls under one of three spectrums. So it's either going to be entertainment, empowerment, or education. So one of
the three E's. Absolutely. I love it.
And I was raised having only educational toys. So it comes very natural to me. And as I mentioned, BC, before Corona, I was dubbed the Carmen San Diego of live stream because in 1 year I traveled like 500,000 miles. It was crazy. It was a lot of miles, around the world and back. I was like every day, just like on a different plane.
Wow.
And this last year I had dropped it down to about 225. And that was like still
a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. And then now Corona hit and Corona was like, hold my beer. Like, we got you. You're going to be home.
Yeah.
And you're going to learn how to travel differently. And so I really have embraced this as a time to pivot towards productivity. My team at Work From Home Network TV, that's one of the things we did. I co-founded a live streaming network. I really wanted to put together my background in live stream and again, provide a platform for people to be able to come together. And so big shout out to Aaron Smalls and the rest of our team, who's my co-founder. We put one of the events
that we're talking about. Very cool.
Yeah. And so we finished our first season. We were producing 11 live shows a week. Wrapped on that right before Thesimo Live, which is what we'll talk about next. And then we're getting ready to launch the second season. But a big thing for me, and Aaron has talked about this and some of the other people on our team, where we wanted to make sure that AC after Corona, we came out of it having been better equipped than when we came in. So what were the new skills? So that would be the big question I would have everyone at home ask themselves. What are the new skills that you're coming out of the great pause, as I like to call it, that are empowering you to really go toward your goals so that, again, you're not just shooting blanks at a wall, hoping something sticks, but that you're really being strategic, that you're really working smarter, not harder, and that you're really elevating yourself to a point where you're like, I didn't even know that I could do that because you've stretched yourself out of your comfort zone. I mean, I saw it firsthand with all the team at Work From Home Network TV. Again, I give a shout out to Aaron Smalls because, man, that man is a creative genius, what he's been able to do and continue to do for our network. And so to that end, like anyone that watched our show, we have like a happy hour live that we do on Fridays. It's interactive. We have a game show. We do, we had the first bilingual show on live stream that was on. Also, Let's Talk About It Live. Let's Talk About It, because I love tacos, live every Tuesday.
I love it.
Power Hour Live is like our version of like Good Morning America or the Today Show, but it all has a twist, all about positivity, sharing the resources that you want to know, and also like just giving you a break of positivity. So we consciously all chose to pivot instead of panic. And then really, as we're pivoting towards productivity, profitability as a result, because you're being productive, and then positivity, really having that as the undercurrent. So what came out of that very early on, it was right after my birthday, I was really bothered by what I was seeing, continuing to see, even where we're at today with our country, that so many people just are not being taken care of during the Great Pause, right? And one of those really is the farm workers of the United States and Puerto Rico. So for all of you who are eating a fresh fruit or vegetable and have been year after year, and especially during this time when none of us can go out, that is actually picked here in the United States by an immigrant farm worker. 9 times out of 10, many of them are undocumented. And unfortunately, they work at lower than any regular minimum wage that we have here. And so you have the numbers about 2 to 3 million. It's not an exact number because so many of them are undocumented, so it's hard to exactly count. But we rounded it off at about 3 million. And so we thought, let's put something together that we can raise money for them, have it go 100% to them and for them, so that they're not only celebrated, but that they actually feel themselves be appreciated. And so Cinco de Mayo, Mayan, I don't know if you know, but like, it really is like the St. Patrick's Day of Latin culture. It's not a real, it's not our real Independence Day. That's September, right?
Yeah.
And so I thought it would be really great if we took back the holiday and we gave it meaning. And we're so used to seeing so many Latinos fight over their flag, like, I'm Guatemalan, I'm Colombian, I'm Salvadorian. And I was like, you know what? Let's all put our flags down. Let's come together and really be there and support these farm workers, who men and women, young and old, who are being there for us in bigger ways that we'll never really get to thank them. And so we were able to, it was called Altissimo Live. I have my shirt on there, supporting farm workers. And basically in 3.5 weeks, we worked around the clock. I slept an average of 25 minutes to 32 minutes if possible a day. And we did it all for free, basically, everyone in front and behind the camera. And what we did was connect over the 100 leading voices in Latin entertainment across 7 countries, 8 time zones for an epic and historical 10-hour, 2-minute and 40-second live stream. And the fund has raised over $1.7 million. And we had everyone from like Juanes to Los Tigres del Norte to, you know, Jay Balvin to Andy Garcia to Dolores Huerta. So it really was connecting leaders, community leaders and activists as much as it was connecting talent. And really to hold space, we were live as well. And so we were taking comments in from people. Right. And it was really fantastic to see our community come together, and to Latino Music, which is a very well-respected network in the Latin world, if you will, came out with their list. They recently bought Me Tu. They came out with their list of the top concerts out of quarantine. And we were so honored that we were number one. And I think what's cool about it, is that we were, let me say thank you. Yeah, like, let me not let that moment pass. Is that we went live, right? Like, was it perfect? No, it had glitches. But part of the glitches is for you to be able to be a part of that, as opposed to, we saw so many taped ones and people just didn't interact positively to that.
Right.
So really leveraging that live for you, it's a risk, but it also pays off so well because people get to feel like they're part of the joke and they're part of something, right?
Yeah.
And in a time where we all want connection, that was super important. So yeah, so was very proud. I learned a lot about how much of the Wild West the music industry is right now with live streaming. unfortunately and fortunately, we're going to see a lot of changes as we continue to see that live events aren't going to happen. You're going to start seeing people charging tickets, and they already kind of have to have these virtual concerts, right? So just a lot of changes are happening in that peak that we were planning it, all these changes started happening. So it went from, you know, people being super happy to have their music played and everyone singing outside their window to them and their labels all calling all the social media networks being like, if you hear our song, we got to be paid or that needs to be shut down. So it was really learning how to navigate that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And usually I would imagine the labels more than the artists driven in terms of wanting payment for exposure. I think most of the artists,
What I was going to say, actually, it's on top of that. I think what a lot of people don't realize, it's not even the artists themselves as well, but it's the composer of the song. So if you are singing a song and you want to go do, I don't know, Feeding Across America, right? Or No Hungry Child, or, you know, whatever it is of these different nonprofits. And you're like, I want to appear and I want to sing my song that I created on TikTok. Okay, great. But if I wrote that song and I don't know what you're doing, I don't necessarily have to say that you can have it. So then that's what we're seeing, is that we had a lot of composers, and to this day, they are so used to their residual checks, and they too have been impacted. So they're like, we're not touring. Right. We're not getting, you know, money that we would normally from our song. So no, if someone's going to sing that live, I want that paycheck. I wrote the song. I want my 53% or my 23% or my 12.2% that I wrote for the song. And you're going to have to pay me something. Now it varies, you know, it can go very low or very high. And so it was a very just interesting situation again, because everybody was doing it to raise as much money as we could for the farm workers. But keeping that in mind, like, there were some hard expenses that needed to be paid. And so a big shout out to all of our supporters that came through and to everybody donated, because all their funds, definitely 100% of that went to the farm workers and to the foundation. But, you know, we also were blessed to have other supporters that showed up to pay for the admin. And that was equally as important, you know? And so it's balancing these things out. And I think when I'm seeing so many other people trying to do live streams, one of the things that I have been hit up a lot is, oh my gosh, I tried playing music on mine and my live stream got shut down. I was like, this is exactly what I'm talking about. So if you're planning these big events, make sure you have someone on your team that understands music clearance in and out. I now have my master's in it, I feel like, after going through the fire, just because it is a very, it's just very complicated. It's very intrinsic. It is very detailed. And it differs per platform. You know, I don't know if you're aware, Mayan, but now some labels are, a lot of them have had beef with Twitter for some time, but now they are anti-TikTok, which I find interesting.
Yes, I have. Yeah, I have heard that. So what TikTok's actually done is they've specifically sent out emails and, you know, messages and communications to people, letting them know that if you have a sponsored post, you're supposed to use it from a specific section of their library that is, like, commercially licensed and allowed for like, promotion. Whereas before, it was, like, kind of a free-for-all of, like, use whatever you want. And so they are definitely getting, they're trying to, I think, adjust and adapt as, you know, the artists and the labels and the producers and composers are all trying to figure out how to work together, I think.
Yeah, it is changing by the week, as I mentioned. So it is a moving end goal that we all just need to be aware of. But at the same time, I understand it. I think everybody wants to make sure that they're being paid and that they're being artistic. Just like we want creators to be paid on TikTok for creating the amazing things that they do, we need to make sure that the composers and the performers are. So it is just all of us being in there together as a community. Personally, though, what I'd love to see is some type of licensing that, as a creator, we could buy into or pay into, kind of the way that, you know, DJs do, or the pods they would do back in the day with, like, sharing vinyls or records with each other. Like, but that way you don't just have to do royalty free music, which a lot of us have to use on YouTube and on other places, but that you also can use this commercially streamed music, which people know. And to be fair, has actually helped put a lot of artists out in the public domain, like Megan Stallion and so many, right? That otherwise would not have been known the way that they are had it not been for the TikTok dances and the challenges. And now you have artists, literally, that's, like, their first thing now for marketing. What TikTok challenge will we be doing with this, right?
Exactly, yeah. What's our TikTok plan? Yeah.
Right? And so it's like, I feel like there needs to be a, I don't know, like a compromise of sorts of saying, like, okay, if you're a content creator and you pay this much a quarter, then like you too can have access to all
like
this
an extra
music.
Library. Like, yeah. No, that'd be really cool. That'd be cool. I'm sure a lot of like creators would pay that, especially because especially if TikTok or the artists were smart about organizing it so that it was easy to match the music to your type of content really well. For me, I have a hard time navigating the current TikTok music library in terms of like really finding what I want for a specific song outside of like if the specific song name is just in my head. But for trying to sort and find a song to match, it's very random feeling at the moment, I would say.
Well, and then as you know, even if you do choose a song and it might be here, it might be clear for here, then they'll tell you that it's not available in another country or you can't hear it because then you have the licenses. Again, you need someone on your team to understand that. How they expect a child to know that, I have no idea. But, you know, that being said, if you are someone that's putting on a plan of a live stream of sorts, do not go blind. Do not, I mean, that's now consulting that I'm doing for a couple of people and for their events. Because I'm like, you do realize by trying to do this live, they're like, well, they won't notice. I was like, no, the algorithm is set up for them to notice if you're going live on any of these platforms. And if you go live on Twitter and Sony is telling you you can't, you will be hit with the lawsuit. And if you go live on any of these other live platforms with music and don't listen, it's a copyright infringement and you will be sued. So it's interesting just to kind of see the play. And again, you don't just have to get the artist, but you have to get the label waiver and you have to get the composer. So, I mean, there's just so much into it. But again, I think it's great to be able to discuss it as we're all looking at what this live stream game is going to look like, because it's been talked about being in the forefront for so long, but that so long is now here in the present. So we're seeing such a rise both in that and with podcasts. That, you know, if you have a voice, if you have a story to share, this is your time to share it. This is your time to start setting up a strategy as to how you want to be out there and be of service. But at the same time, to educate yourself on the things that you need to do it so that you're doing it without getting in trouble.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I'd love your opinion on this, but I think one thing that we're going to start seeing with the music industry and with music artists is them realizing that really the music sale, anything that comes in revenue wise for the music is not necessarily their biggest potential source of revenue. That as their music allows them to grow a large following on social media, that they have much bigger opportunities in many, many, many areas. And I think that's going to push a lot of them to thinking, well, I'll share the music for free because like I'm playing the long game. I'm not playing so much the short game of like, I need this money right now. But at the same time, I think, right, there's always that kind of starving artist mentality of like, I got to get, you know, rent paid. I got to get the next, you know, paycheck in. So I'd love, what do you think? Do you think it's going to push one way or the other?
You know, what's interesting is I feel like you're right. I think at the end of the day, and I'm so glad that you actually brought up the starving mentality. Like, I want to give a big shout out to Manny5158 who said that I'm reading the comments. And I am actually, because I think it's important for us to have a conversation. And I think part of that is that artist mentality of, you know, this is something I talk about in my second book, The Word Diet, which I'm working on now. I speak about the most important meal of the day is the words that you feed yourself. Right? Because that is actually what defines your mindset. And that's what defines the actions that you take and what defines what you share with others. So that really creates your world for you. And so you have to ask yourself, are you living and coming from a place of creativity and positivity? Or are you coming from a place of lack and fear? Because in doing that, that defines that artist poverty mentality. I mean, I've been told since I was a child, like, oh, you want to be an actor? Oh, you want to be a storyteller? You're never going to make money. I was like, what are you talking about? Like, that is not my reality. Like, of course I'm going to make money, but it's not because I'm going to go seek it. It's because I know that I'm going to be of service and I'm going to have value. And one thing that my grandma used to always tell me, may she rest in peace, she would always say that some people are so poor, all they have is money. So I want you to hear that again. Some people are so poor, all they have is money. They focus so much on chasing the bag and chasing like, that was mine. I did that. I did this. That they lose the bigger picture of understanding what their purpose is and what has real value. Connection, like the conversations we're having right now, has real value. I, you know, am so moved and so angered and disturbed about what we're seeing going on with George Floyd, but I'm so relieved to see that the officer was put into custody today. And that came as a result of people protesting, of people calling, myself included, you know, the office, people sharing it and people having these difficult discussions. So it's like putting things into action that move whatever your chip is forward. That's what we all need to focus on. So when you have this mindset of poverty thinking, of like starving artists, I just don't know if I can do it. It's a bummer for, because we all lose, right? If you're coming from a place already of lack, then you're already coming at it from a disability as opposed to empowering yourself to be like, okay, let me figure out how do I navigate this system? How do I navigate the great pause? How do I navigate the situation and come out ahead? So in doing that, another thing I want to share, and one of my favorite quotes, I, again, very blessed to, work very hard at a young age, knowing what I wanted and to have opportunity to be seen, right? And so many of the interviews that I've done of actors, fellow actors like myself, but also legends like Prince, and I want to defer to him with this particular quote. I remember the first time I interviewed him, I asked him like what his take was on creativity. And it was so great to hear it and then hear a longer explanation. And then I'm going to circle back to Michael Jackson bringing it up. But it was funny because he said, you know, when you have an idea, the minute you speak it out into the universe, it is no longer yours. It is in the ethos. It is out there. So when I had an idea, I didn't care where I was. This is why at Paisley Park, I had to have my piano and my studio ready to go. If it was in the middle of the night, I'd have to jump and run down to the studio. Because if I knew I didn't put pen to paper and get started on what I was going to do, the muse was going to leave me and I was going to head over to Michael Jackson. And Michael Jackson was going to get the song and he was going to write it. And now it was going to be him. And I was going to sit there and pout and be like, oh, he stole it. He didn't steal it. The muse came through me. If I wasn't ready to accept her, she was going to keep on keeping on. And it was interesting because I heard an interview with Michael Jackson years later, literally talking about the same thing in reverse, that he remembered one time hearing a song and he was out in the field somewhere and he was like booking it home and was like, I gotta go. Where's the car? If I don't get it, Prince is gonna get this song. So it's interesting to me when you see these two legends, you know, in music, I don't want to speak about them personally, but in music, the fact that they were so tapped into source, whether you want to call that God, universe, you know,
energy.
Yeah, LaCroix, water, whatever you want to call source, you know, you are tapped in, right? And so being able to be tapped in and know that when it leaves your mouth, it is no longer yours. Just like when you put a TikTok out there, when I create a video, when I create something, it's no longer mine. However, there are copyright rules, right? There are trademarks. There are things that you can protect yourself. But even then, Forever 21 is known for knocking off like these designers and what have you, right? So, but their whole thing is that there's that trademark rule. Like you have to make sure that you change it at least 20% to make it yours, right? So it's an interesting thing when you have IP, because what is truly yours and what is a collective source, right? So one thing that we see that a lot with, I would say in social media is, you know, I've seen so many of my ideas get reposted by other people. Sometimes they get credited, sometimes they don't. I've seen it happen on TikTok. I saw it on Vine. I saw it on Periscope. I mean, it's nothing new. It's not going to change. And so I'd love to ask you, like, how do you deal with that, with like shouting out people that are up and comers? How do you empower it? How do you repost? What is your philosophy behind that?
Yeah, honestly, I feel like I'm coming from a place of really good intention when I post and share other artists' work. I know as an artist, and having dealt with and talked to so many other artists, that one of the things they struggle the most with is marketing. And I happen to be, that's like my strong suit. That's what I'm, you know, very good at. And so I can do marketing for myself and for other people. And so that's what I love to do. I think I'm definitely an abundance mentality mindset. And so I think if I can create more interest in other people's artwork, that's a wonderful thing for everyone, for me, for the really just for everyone in general, just because I feel artwork is such a powerful thing. Like art is good for everyone. It lowers crime rates. It like helps your health physically. It does so many powerful things. So I think the more anyone can share artwork, the better. And
can you give a tangible example of how you've done that on TikTok?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's quite a few amazing, amazing, talented artists on Instagram. And what I'll do is I'll, you know, I know them now. And so I, you know, I kind of scroll their pages to see, did they post something new today? Did they post something new today? And if I see it, I'm like, oh, awesome. Let me post that to TikTok. And I've actually even moved a couple of them from Instagram to TikTok through posting there and gotten them to create their own accounts. Like Josh Birnbaum Glass is one of them. Another one would be, I don't know if Erin Carty's on there yet, but I post her stuff on Instagram, and she always like loves it, and she follows up all the comments and is, you know, turns those guys into customers, which is awesome. Yes. So like, artists are good at sales, but they're bad at marketing. So if I can help people get into, you know, their door, so to speak, which is really just any kind of online contact, then I think that's wonderful. So I'd love to be able to tag everyone on TikTok. Unfortunately, a lot of the artists are still just on Instagram. So what I'll do is I'll try and share that video to my Instagram also. And so then I can tag them in the Instagram post. And I always make sure on my Instagram posts say, you know, go. So I tell my followers, go show some love on their page, because I think that matters. And like you said, people want to feel part of something positive and inclusive. And it's really like, there is a lot of negativity out there, but when you're doing good things and you're doing them with good intentions and there's really no one getting hurt at all, outside of people who are already hurt, I just don't have any bad feelings about that at all.
Yeah. And I also think, and I love that you're sharing your perspective, because I think, you know, one of the things, my friend Taylor, she did the story about the little girl who created the Renegade Dance. And it was so great because I love how TikTok culture changed as a result of that, of giving credit for people that did like the dances, right? And so Taylor was really, I don't know if you read her story in the New York Times, but it really changed this little girl's life who had been going on, tagging Charlie, tagging all these people. All she wanted was credit. Like, she saw this song blow up and her dance blow up. And she was like, listen, like, I'm not even trying to get paid. Can I just get some credit? She just wanted to be seen. She was a young artist and a creator. And I so love that the artist not only stepped up, but had her on his channel, then on TikTok, and then Charlie credited her. But it really changed and singled this difference of how important it is. And now I see all these creators like, oh, let me know who created this dance, right? Like, it reminded me of Bring It On, right? Like, where you had people that were getting a little bit offended, where they were like, oh, you're going to one school taking the dances and you're taking them over here and you're not giving me credit, right? So I feel like as long as credit is given, then it's a win-win for everybody, right? Because to your point, what you said, if there's something that you see and you, it's kind of like a duet, right? Like, if you see something and you do a duet, or you see something and you want to make it better, you have an idea. That's why they become trends on TikTok, right? And that's why they become trends on some of these social platforms. Then I feel like that's where, again, it's in the ether, right? But then how do you build on that? How do you make it your own? How do you do your spin? And then from there, you just keep building and growing. And so it's awesome to see that some of the creators have really appreciated what you already have done. And, you know, and I would say for those that, you know, want more, want to continue to grow, that they also look at you to see, like, not only what you're doing, but also, you know, using that strategy of finding other creators out there that they can get inspired with, that they can collaborate. That would be my, like, second takeaway that I would give to people, that they, like, I get hit up on the daily, like, hey, I'd love to do something with you, or hey, I'd love to you know, figure out. And it's like, cool. Okay, what can we do to be of service? Because first of all, I will tell you, please don't ever tell someone that you want to pick their brain. Anytime I hear that, I feel like I see the Grinch in his nail, like, just scratching
your visual.
Like, yeah, and I'm like, no, I don't want that. No, no, no. But like, or someone would be like, can I buy you coffee? And I'm like, first of all, I don't drink coffee. If you knew me, you would know that. I love coffee. Maybe buy me a taco or send me a gift card these days, since we can't go get one, and we can talk. But that being said, I love being so giving, but I also have invested quite a bit amount in my education, both my undergrad, my master's, my second master's, like, just like daily. So there's several hundred thousand dollars in my brain that I've, like, invested on, and I've been blessed that my family has too. And so the reason, and I love this meme that they said, like, oh, sometimes, you know, you're not paying someone for how long it takes them to do something. You're paying them for the knowledge and the years it took them to learn how to do X, Y, Z, right? So I would always say to that, like, when I see someone that has used something or has been inspired by something that I've done, I'm always like, mazel. Like, that's awesome. I'm so glad to know that I, like, you know, inspired you in one way. I would hope that you give me credit. But if you don't, I'm also, I have, my grandma used to always say this, because I've been ripped off so much, especially because I've been in this business as a kid, that she'd be like, Liza, they can take your idea all day long, but they can't take your brain. Like, being a badass content creator is knowing how to come up with idea after idea after idea. So
yeah,
I do not. I have, and I'll show you here, like, my book. Can Can you see it? My book that I'm in. Like I will fill it up. That's like what's blank. But like I have like all my notes. Like it goes with me everywhere I go. I learned this tip from Richard Branson, who takes his little red book with him everywhere. Because again, it's about the muse leaving you and being like, oh, what is this thing? I need. Oh, okay, wait. Let me just write this down, just so that I know, like, you know, what it is that I am thinking and that I want to grow on and stuff. So, you know, I would say that. That being said, though, I think giving credit is important. I think that. Being proper about it is great. Holding discussion and holding space for it is great. But I also think that it's important for people not to assume. And I also think it's important for people to focus on what's next. So yeah, that's kind of my take on it too.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I'd say another thing is like, I am totally of the mindset where like, I'm okay if people have a different opinion than me. Mm-hmm. Like that's totally okay. You can think that the way I do it is wrong. And that's okay. I can think, right? We can all have these different opinions about how things should or should not be done.
Republicans, right?
Yeah, like, exactly. Like classic. Yeah. Politics, right? We all have opinions about how it should be. And like more often than not, people tie that to morality or like these deeper things that it just isn't. You can disagree without someone being evil in that situation. Like both people can be great people and just have a disagreement. I think, you know, where that starts to not be so true is when people start using language that is like, you know, homophobic or derogatory towards different races. And I think that's never okay. Like in my personal opinion, it's never okay to be disrespectful to someone for really any reason, even if someone's harming you. Let's say it's totally understandable that you're probably going to be disrespectful, but like you shouldn't be, because it's not good for your own soul and it doesn't help the situation. It doesn't resolve things.
Yes. You just reminded me. I was like, gosh, darn it. I wish I was closer to my office. I was going to bring you, I have these pair of like squishy balls, but they're in the shape of women breasts, if you will. And the reason why this was actually sent as a joke from a fan, because a community member of mine, because when Periscopes first started, one of the big things that you would see, especially from men in the Middle East, you know, just very different way that women are viewed, it would be like, show breasts, show this, show that. And they would get very explicit with what they were asking to like literally you were on 2 seconds that you don't even get a high. They'd be like, show breasts, show this. Show. And I'm like, wait, what is happening? And so very early on, my community and I decided that we were going to hold space for positivity and that that just wasn't going to be allowed. And I always tell people, like, same thing with politics or anything else. Like, I will always be open for discussion, but please come through with intelligent thought and come through with receipts. Don't come through with assumptions. Don't come through with memes made by a third grader. I need actual thoughts that have been planned out and that there's facts behind them. I was a poli sci major and I double minor in economics and Japanese, and I was pre-law. So I come from a very head-based, I was, you know, nationally ranked debate. I'm like, if we're going to do this,
analytical, and creative all in one.
Yeah. And so I loved when Periscope started, because you started seeing literally all these people be like, show feet, show this, show that. And I was like, yeah, that's not happening here. This is my space. This is my page. So we're going to, and I remember we even like nicknamed like the pig alert. And so we would throw up like the little pig emoji, and my community started self-policing where they're like, there's a pig alert, because they literally would just be asking these. And so I would say for like the top, out of the top 20, there was 8 girls and continue to be like in that list. And so a great group of women ended up getting together to send us these like stress balls of boobs and be like, next time someone asks you to like show them, you can show them this instead.
That's funny.
Which just made me laugh. So again, it's like, how do you pivot towards positivity? How do you like, you know, flip the script? But also it's super important to understand like, what do you hold space for on your own platforms, right? And what's the kind of conversation that you're trying to create, and where are you, what is the goal, right? And
right. What is the goal? And where are you, if where you're spending your time isn't getting you towards that goal, it's like, don't do that thing. And I think that's where a lot of people get really stuck, is they get distracted by something that's driving their emotion and they don't reflect on, is this helping me? Or like, is this just a waste of my time?
Right.
Yeah. And no one wants to waste their time. So I want to hear from you a little bit more about Vine. You said you were, you know, a big influencer and kind of blew up on Vine. When did you get into Vine? What happened with Vine?
Yeah, pretty much when it started as well, and stayed pretty on. I think, again, so many of the strategies that you're seeing in TikTok are things that we did on Vine or things that we did.
Example. Like, what's an example of that?
So an example is like user behavior, right? So like one thing I'll tell you is for live stream in particular, since that's what we're on. So for this one, I'll go to Periscope and then I'll go back to Vine. But when it first started, everybody would grab their phone and they would literally hit record and you would see feet. So we were like, oh my God, people are tired of seeing feet. Can you make sure that you have the phone up, like that you're going to record, right? And people would just do this weird thing where they were on live and they just kind of would stare as like they were supposedly waiting for like people to come on or whatever. And you're like, one for talking because you're going to lose engagement, right? So for all of us that were on there and I was on 2 days after it launched and it was still in beta, right? We very early became thinking like, what is a way that we can connect communities? So we started doing a roll call of like, let us know where you're in from, like, where are you at? Right. And that really came to play with us. So I was the first, the only correspondent really first for Formula E, which is basically like Formula One, but the electronic version. And then I was also the first social media influencer for NASCAR. And so I'm really into cars. So traveled the world with them for that. And so for Formula E, one of the races ended up going down in Miami. And I remember, mind you, I didn't have this phone, but it was an iPhone. And I have a couple of phones and devices that I use. And I had a little mini mouse. This is so funny. Little mini mouse cover on it. And I'm such a big kid.
Oh, with the ears
and the little
totally,
bow.
Totally, I know those.
So, I was getting ready, like we're behind the scenes, but I was going to go live. But I also was shooting for my YouTube. And I do a lot of like white label stuff for brands and stuff. And so I was working with the brand and I thought, okay, this is great. Well, all of a sudden, I remember they were bringing Richard Branson to me. And this was like literally 2 weeks after Periscope, had launched. And I was like, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to hold the camera and go live and try to interact. Like, cause they're like, right, you can only do one. And I had my mic and I was like, okay. And so it's one of those moments where I had a crossroad. Like, this is a crossroad. This is going to be defining, but I need to make a choice. So anyhow, I end up putting my camera down and I end up picking up my phone and decide to go live. But before I go live, as he's walking over, I'm like literally on and I'm like saying, okay, here we go. I was like, okay, hi guys. All right, I'm about to interview, Richard Branson. Do me a favor. Can you all type what city you're from? And when I say go, then drop it so that he can see it. And I'm like, okay, this would be great, right? So I'm like there. I was like, okay, cool. So we're ready to go. So he walks up and he was like, hey, he's like, so do you have your camera? And his team's like super formal with me. And I'm like, yeah, so we're all live. I'm like, hi, Richard. It's so great to see you again. How have you been? Let's talk about your driver. Let's talk about your team. And he's like, what are you shooting? Is this a call FaceTime? Like, what's going on?
He's like, what's happening?
Like, yeah. And I was like, no, we're actually on live and we're connected with the world. And he's like, really? And I was like, all right, Love Ignition, you know what to do. Drop your city. So literally everybody starts dropping their city. And he got like so excited. It started going through and he literally, Maya, like froze. And he was like, what is this? And I was like, it's called Periscope. And literally people were like in real time, letting him know where he was. And that was, or where they were. And that was one of those defining moments. He became super addicted to the live stream platform after. I ended up having a chat with him once we wrapped with his team. He wanted to learn, wanted to invest, just thought this was so great. And it was the future. And look at where we're at now, right?
Yeah.
And it's been crazy to see that behavior has continued, that is now what people do. Like, it's a roll call of like, where are you at? Let us know. Like,
I do it on my live streams. Absolutely. It's really fun. Yeah, absolutely. Anything you can do, I think, to build a sense of community through engagement and through communication and through shared connectivity, right? It's like, what things do we have in common? Well, even though we're all from all different places all over the world, we're coming together on this live stream. You know, we're all dropping where we're from, which is like an act in community, in communion, which I think is really cool. And it just makes you feel like I'm here. Yes, I'm here, but I'm also here right now. And I've committed to being here by dropping my city, my state, my country. Yep. I love that.
Yep. So your flag. I mean, that's what we did for these flags. Yep. People dropping in that. Their flags and their emojis. Cause we had, you know, again, we had people from 7 different countries. So that was also super awesome and super cool just to see like Colombia in the house or Puerto Rico, right, or Vancouver, like just to kind of see where people were. So yeah.
It's exciting. So, yeah. It's really exciting. You're like, oh wow, someone from this completely other country just like communicated with me. It's very exciting. It doesn't, and it really, I don't think wears off, even though it's something like you can experience again and again, cause it's a new person, or even when it's the same person, that's almost more exciting. Sometimes you're like, it's you again, out of all the billions of people in the world, we're connecting again from across the ethers.
It's the coolest thing. One of my dear friends said, he's like, it's like Party Line, like from back in the day where like everybody like would jump on and you're like, wait, what? And he's like, yeah, like everybody would like get one number and stuff. And I was like, oh my gosh. And then this guy, like, I just continued to hear this like reference. I was like, Party Line, you're right. It is kind of like that. And now obviously we're seeing everybody try like their chance at it. But I think also one of the cool things, going back to your question about Vine, that we're seeing too is characters, right? Like Vine was a space for so many of us to create new characters. So I have like 4 or 5 characters there that were quite popular and had their own little following, which was great. And so I'm definitely bringing them back for TikTok. And I have some ideas of what I want to do there just to have it be like a place to create. Again, one of the things right now, again, going back to the ABC that we were talking about of always be creating, is being DC during quarantine. I really feel like, okay, I've used my philanthropy muscle. I've used my creation muscle. I created this network. I've, you know, am giving back. I see what's going on with my business. But now like my acting side, like I really need to do something from that creative point. So I was like, all right, I got to bring those back. I want to start building some characters, you know, really tap into my improv side and yeah, show people what I got and, you know, and collaborate with people. Like, again, it's not even, and I love, who did I hear this recently, but who was it that I was talking to? And they're like, listen, at the end of the day, when I create something, as long as I like it and I sign off on it, it doesn't matter if anyone else likes it. And I so love that. And I appreciate that. Cause that's the thing, as an artist, when you make something, it's yours. I'm sure you see that with Class Flowing as well, right? Like,
absolutely. For me, it's a combination of 2 things. One, did I like it? But then I think following that up, if I can match it with someone else who really loves it, right, then I don't care what anyone else thinks about it, even myself. Yep. Like if I can find something I made and I think it's kind of ugly, but someone else goes, wow, I love that part of it. And it's so cool. I got to have it. Like that makes me feel really good.
You froze.
Oh, am I good?
Can someone screenshot? Hopefully someone screenshotted.
Hopefully I'm just frozen to you and not to everyone.
Yeah. Oh, no, you're good.
Okay, cool. It was a glitch. We just moved down into a new duplex unit today. So the internet might be a little more glitchy than normal. I'm going to do a couple shout outs right now to some people who are amazing and watching on LinkedIn. Michael, who's coming in from Connecticut. Woot woot. As he says, I love the woot woot. I love noise effects and sound effects. So definitely woot woot to you.
Hold on. I got you. Also from my Periscope days, that is also like, come over, hold please. Also, I aside from tacos, I also love unicorns. I really am.
And rainbows. So I like rainbows a lot.
You can give them a round of applause.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Round of applause. I love it. We got John Watson. We got David. I can't pronounce your last name, but we got David in the house. He said, just look at ringtones. They're making a fortune, which is kind of a fascinating thing. Ringtones have like come back really, really strong and hard. Mm-hmm. They disappeared for a while. They were like not a thing. And now they're a big thing. And I think that has something to do with
TikTok.
Yeah. It's really hard to think that 10-second, 6-second time frame and the virality and people sharing the way that they do with TikTok doesn't have a very direct effect on that.
I love that you said sharing, right? So I'm working on this like super secret project right now, and it's all about spreading love in a cool way, in a different way. And I'm excited to share with everybody. So if you're not already following, feel free to follow XOXO Liza with Susie's, please, on all things social, because it'll be coming out next week. But it's an international project with some people that you know. And so it's super pumped. And again, I'm all about, my whole thing is that I see the world through love-filled eyes. You'll always see me wearing my heart-shaped glasses of some sort. I have over 200 pairs at this point that my community members from around the world have sent me, which is really awesome. And so what I love about it is that it really inspired me to find different ways to share, you know, share kindness and share love. And, you know, I'm loving people not only creating their songs, like I'm bored in the house on TikTok, that thing
right.
gets in my house and it's ear candy. Like it's an earworm. I'm always like, oh, I know that song. Right. So kind of to what you were saying with like the beats and stuff, but also like how people are using it to embrace body positivity. Like I know for myself, like I was in a bad accident, and that unfortunately, due to medicine that I was taking, ended up making me gain weight. And then if the medication gets lowered, I lose weight. Like it goes back and forth, you know, which is crazy. But regardless, at the end of the day, I'm still me. And so I embrace that. And anybody else that doesn't want to embrace that, I'm like, well, then that's on you. But like, I know I'm Latin. We're born sexy. We're born like sensual. Like, and I'm all about it. But it's really great to see people embracing their size, regardless if they're thin, if they're thick, if they're, you know, whatever word they want to use. If they're curvaceous, like I think it's great. I love seeing how the app itself on TikTok, because I've seen a lot of body positivity on there, is being used, yes, for the dances, yes, for some of this other creation stuff like music tones, but also for ways of giving back. I love that they recently added and have really put an emphasis on social good and on giving back like this whole month.
Yeah, just for people who don't know, they've been matching every mm-hmm. single dollar donated up to $10 million that people are giving through the platform mostly through their live streams. Talking about live streaming, it started out with like Facebook being this revolutionary thing that, oh, you could collect money for charities and give money through Facebook and through a social media. And that was a static thing. And now it's like an active live streaming giving, and it's so powerful. And that's what happened with Altissimo Live, to be able to do $1.7 million in a single day is like,
well, since the first time, so in March and then, over it. And so like in a day, it was like over 700,000, but it's been amazing. Crazy, and people have continued to just give money. And now Instagram has added to it too, which is great on their features of making it easier to donate or to host a live stream that's for donation. You know, what P. Diddy did as well for the frontline workers when he had his dance-a-thon with all his friends, he raised several million in a day too. So it's like, people are seeing the impact that a little bit goes a long way. There's another project that I'm working on that we've invited you to be a part of too, that is also for social good, to make an impact. A big shout out to Spicy Doug, who is the mastermind behind it. You know, it's finding the different ways that we really can give back and make an impact that I think make the most. I have to find a way to discuss my addiction to LaCroix. That is a great TikTok.
Have to bring it up.
Yep, carbonated water. I don't drink soda. I don't drink coffee. I have enough energy, but I do limit some water and some iced tea. So I'm like, cool. That's a great thing about TikTok, right? Like you can make whatever be its thing, but also I think just the social media, right? Like my community knows just how much I love tacos and how much I love to travel. And, you know, as soon as we're in AC and I can get on a plane again safely, I will be there. And I already have some destinations in mind, but in the meantime, I'm excited to continue to do the quarantine passport with them. I actually like created a whole little PDF. I put like my teaching skills into effect so that people could do it and we could watch like videos and
stuff.
That's
cool. That's cool.
Yeah. It's just really using your creativity as much as you can to make the best out of it.
Absolutely. So that leads me into kind of my final question here, which is, what is next in the foreseeable, let's say next couple months, half a year, full year? It sounds like you want to get out there. How long do you think it's going to be before you're really traveling again? And then also, where is your, like, you've got so much awesome stuff going on. Where is your main focus, or is it really kind of evenly divided? And how do you decide that too?
So that's a lot of questions, but I will tackle them all, which is great.
Take one.
Like, it's fantastic. So next couple of months, you know, I think, again, I'm going to continue to be dedicated to pivoting towards positivity and productivity. It's what I've always done. It's what I'll continue to do. I have this awesome project that I'm excited about announcing next week. So super pumped about that. So definitely stay tuned for that. I wish I could tell you guys.
It's so mysterious.
Yeah, it's been so fun. And I had like a nice little behind the scenes yesterday. Like, and it really was, you know, the thing I always talk about is putting love in action and spreading love. And I said that even before Corona. So BC, like right. BBC, I would always be like, hashtag spread love. I have it here in our topic too. Same thing with, you know, Love Bug Nation and putting love in action. And so I really feel like I'm excited to get back to putting, how would I say this? Like doing more tangible projects as I travel. Like I did one in Cuba. I did one in Dominican Republic. Like I served as a youth ambassador there as well. Like in Cuba, we actually laid down concrete for a village of 200 people with different family members or community members of mine that came out. Because I don't know if you know, but the average person in Cuba makes about $20 US dollars a month. And concrete is $5 a pound. And so unfortunately, these people can't even have a basic necessity like a floor. So their stuff, even if they're living in a shack or a shanty or a basic house made out of brick, their floor is mud. So that leads to a lot of disease. And that during the summer, being in the Caribbean, that leads to their furniture also flowing out and nothing staying. And so we raised money as a community and went down there and literally I rolled up my sleeves with my community members and we, you know, laid down the concrete. So I'm not scared to get, you know, to get to work. If it's going to make an impact. And so doing things like that, doing that at BCMO Live was really fantastic. I'm excited to continue to merge nonprofit with, you know, or social good, I would say, with my platform, but also seeing what we're doing with Work From Home Network TV. We have a whole new season coming up of shows, which is great. And we have some brand collaborations that we're discussing. And, you know, it's been cool being the pioneers of the way that this live streaming 3.0 is kind of taking off with events. And because events aren't going to be back to normal for quite some time, I'm excited to explore how we can be of service and how we can really leverage that and be a bridge between community as well as those that are putting on the event. So I would say that's the big thing. And then finishing my book, really excited to do the book and a course with it. My first book, I became a best-selling author, is called Latina Empowerment Through Leadership. And we went number one, 7 different categories, and book on Amazon, we're in Barnes & Noble. And that was a great book. But what came out of that was too my community being like, okay, I want more. And so I'm like, okay, let me give you more. So I'm like super excited always about just empowering people. Like even if it's a waiter and I'm somewhere, I'm like, I'm giving you homework. Like here's how I can think of myself, right? Because I want to see everybody live their best life. And absolutely. I'm like, have you thought about this? Have you thought about this? I think when you and I first met, I was like, have you thought about this? Like,
yeah, no, you know? I love it. You know, even just putting the seeds of words into people's heads, even if they don't really like it at first, it plants sometimes a beautiful tree and it can really help them grow. And it can help them grow too. Absolutely. Yeah, so it's
all about helping people grow. And I would say, you know, I'm focused on what's next. There was a couple of projects acting-wise that I was casted for that had to be put on hold because of the great pause. So it's exciting to see what's going to happen. Some people are exploring doing Zoom movies. Jennifer Lopez just shot a scene.
I've heard of that.
So we're gonna roll. But the name of the game is really being adaptable, right? And being flexible.
Innovation. Yeah.
And innovative and also creative. So I am excited for what lies ahead. I know so many people are scared, but I was raised to come from a place of abundance. And I say this, and I don't say this to be glim, but you know, I had a very difficult childhood through no fault of my mom or my grandmother or anything, but I endured some very interesting things that children probably shouldn't. And as a result, like if I could survive that, there really isn't much else that I can't survive. So I really look at how I was able to turn my life around with my mindset and with really making sure that I created boundaries for myself and to feel safe. And in doing that, I make sure that when I am, I'm very protective of my community so that I'm not only sharing resources that help my community grow, but also heal and to also think of things differently and empower them to have a voice, to be heard, to have fun. Laughter is a form of medicine that people forget. Absolutely. Spreading love is a form of medicine. So I don't take my job lightly in that way as a creator or as an actor or as a storyteller, and also as a community leader. And so I'm excited to see how I could be of service for everyone.
That is so awesome to hear. So if you guys want to get in touch with Liza, how can they best do, what's the best platform?
Yes. So I'm on all of them, which is great. I have an amazing team that helps me keep track on all of them. So yeah, XOXO Liza with two Z's, please, on all social media, even the social media that hasn't been created. And I'm verified.
Who's going to be first day one?
Yes, day one.
Going to be on there. Pioneer. Absolutely. Yeah,
so that I'm verified, so that you know there are some impersonators out there, but you'll know because it'll have a little blue check mark that it's me. And then, yeah, I've been getting a lot of requests for people asking for graduation shout outs or Joseph inspiration, positivity, birthday shout outs. I also got some apology requests. So yeah, you can go to cameo.com/Liza, which is my first name. I'm happy to do the cameos for everybody there. And then I'm launching a mentor program as well, which will be on superpeer.com. Same thing,
superpeer.com/Liza.
So you can book me there. We could do a deep dive for an hour and really get into it with your business. Again, I'm all about being of service. And one of my skills and one of my gifts is really being able to connect the dots quickly for people in a variety of ways. So whether that's with social media, whether you're interested in getting started in acting, I will show you how to navigate through the show so that you get down to business. There's a lot of cons in this business. You need to know that. I use my smarts, my book smarts, as well as my street smarts to be able to tell you, like, here's how you get to work. Like, do you want to just study acting or do you want to be a working actor, right? And same thing with the content creator lifestyle, whether you are embracing the word influencer, or whether you want to create content, what it's like to actually work with brands, what that looks like. A lot of people want to get started and they have really great ideas, but either they're giving it all away for free or they're overcharging and not really delivering that the way they should. So I really take pride in it being able to connect those dots for people. So yeah, so superpeer.com/Liza, L-I-Z-Z-A. I'm there to help as well. Or if you just want to say hi, feel free to just slide into the DMs, the PMs. I'm there.
Yeah, you guys, Liza is an incredible, incredible resource, I think, especially for other creators. Definitely, you know, for me is an amazing resource in helping me become a better creator, unlock some of my creativity, and also, again, understanding parts of the industry that Liza has been through and has firsthand experience with that I don't. I've heard maybe a story about. And it's you know, very hard to be confident in this crazy Wild West world of influencing if you don't have someone, I think, helping to guide you in some aspect. And so, like, I have lots of people that help guide me. And Liza is absolutely someone who can help guide you guys if you're looking for it. So thank you so much for taking the time to be here and talk about all these amazing things. I look forward to catching up and, you know, following up with you a bit later. If you guys have any follow-up questions for me, you know how to get in touch with me on LinkedIn, on Instagram, on Facebook. Hope you guys have a great night and we will see you tomorrow.
Bye. Have a great weekend.